Hare Krishna. So today morning we're discussing on the first canto. So this section, I see it as the place where the Bhagavatam meets the Mahabharat. That the Bhagavatam is mostly spoken after the events of the Mahabharat have ended. However, the Bhagavatam, like a sidelong back glance towards the Mahabharata is given, and here it is given in the form of Arjuna's remembrances of how Krishna helped him throughout. So a couple of weeks ago I spoke on the pastime of Mayadana and how through the whole set of events Krishna brought fortune through misfortune for the Pandavas. Now, in today's session, I'll talk about what happened in the Maya Sabha. So, misfortune in the palace of illusion. The Maya Sabha, it has an interesting double meaning. Prabhupada points to that in his purport also. Maya is the name of the person. And the activity that he did was also to create illusion, Maya. So, actually, to do anything in the world requires expertise. To do anything constructive requires expertise. Now, random destruction is easy to do. You can just pick up and throw something. But if somebody wants to do systematic destruction, then that requires intelligence. So, Prabhupada talks about dushkrutinaha, that people have kruti in 716. He says that people have capacity, ability, but they use it in a misdirected way. When the Twin Towers collapsed, it was an act of brutal ingenuity. It was very intelligent, but it was also brutal. So there were many kids after that in schools, especially in America, they did projects of how we could bring the Twin Towers down. And then they were told how you could protect it, prevent it from happening. So Maya, his expertise is in creating illusion. So the palace that he had created was a palace where there was a lot of illusion, and the illusion was in the form of, basically when we talk about illusion, it essentially means Maya, that is a Sanskrit word. Things are not the way they appear to be. That is the essence of illusion, that there is substance and there is appearance. And illusion means the appearance and substance do not match. So, when our perception is accurate, is real, when the illusion and when the appearance and substance match. Whereas our perception is an illusion when the appearance and substance don't match. And when somebody creates an illusion, that means what they do is that they do something in such an expert way by which they make it natural to perceive the appearance and substance differently. Like most magic tricks, they are basically sleight of hands. The magician is doing one thing and directs our attention in one direction, while they do something somewhere else by which it appears as if it was, you know, as if they pulled out a rabbit out of a hat, something like that. So, illusion essentially means a mismatch between appearance and substance. So when that is created, that also requires expertise. So the illusion that Maya Sabha, it refers to the palace created by Maya, but is also another translation for that, the palace of illusion, because Maya can refer to the person and slightly change that, Maya refers to illusion. So it was a palace of illusion, and the illusion was Trisargo Yenam, as it says in Bhagavatam. In the first verse it says that where it is land, it appears to be water. Where it is water, it appears to be land. Basically, just as the Supreme Lord creates this world where there is illusion. And it is by seeing how believable the illusion is, how captivating the illusion is, that we actually appreciate the brilliance of the Lord. So why is the Bhagavatam talking in the first verse itself? I meditated on that Lord who makes the unreal appear real. Now different acharyas have given different meanings for what unreal and real mean over there. But simply put, the point is that to pull off an illusion successfully requires expertise. So Maya Sabha refers to the place where the illusion was pulled off in a brilliant way. And there was one particular character who was a victim of that illusion. Who was that? Duryodhana, yes. So there are certain incidents in our epics, the Mahabharata or the Ramayana, where the moral lines seem to get blurred. So normally, for example, if somebody is walking and they slip and fall, a normal human reaction, empathic human, compassionate human reaction would be to rush to that person and to help them get up. Normally, if somebody is walking and they slip and fall, we don't laugh at that person. We would consider that to be strange, even uncultured to do like that. So the question comes up that when Duryodhan mistook what was water to be land and he slipped and fell. So why did Draupadi laugh at that time? And as if that is not bad enough, in some dramatic renditions of the Mahabharata, it is depicted as if Draupadi not only laughed at him, but also taunted him. And how did she taunt him? She said, "Andhe ka beta andha." The son of a blind is blind. Son of the blind. So now, as far as I have seen, the Mahabharata has different recensions. But whichever recension we go to, I have not seen this in the actual Mahabharata. Because sometimes old books, especially if they are very large, then some things might get changed in during the Pathantara. It's called Pathantara means, in the past we didn't have, there was no facility to print books. So then if the paper on which the book was written, or whatever, the leaves on which the book was written, whatever material was there, because India has a tropical environment, so it doesn't last for very long. So they have to rewrite it. And while rewriting it, there can sometimes be some changes that happen. So that is called as Pathantara Bhed. So whenever there is any traditional commentary written, so for example, Madhvacharya or Ramacharya, when Ramacharya writes in the Bhagavad Gita commentary, so before that, there is some description. Okay, I have seen these different recensions, and some places this verse is like this, some places this verse is like this. And then the Acharya might describe, okay, both verses could, even if you use whichever meaning, this is what the import is. Or they may say this is the right version because of this, this, this. So there is like a usually a section where this is called textual analysis is done. So for the Mahabharata, there is the Bhandarkar Research Institute in Pune, which did a multi-year project with many, many scholars together, and they brought a critical edition. Even in the critical edition, they have not included this. So this is just a dramatization. And that dramatization is good if it conveys the essential point in a more emphatic way. But dramatization is bad when it gives a different import or gives an opposite import. So I'll talk about this a little bit later. But so I said that first, I said the 3 degrees of problem are there. First is that why did Draupadi laugh at Duryodhan? Then did she actually taunt him? And then on top of that, in the Bhagavatam, it is described that when Yudhishthir saw him falling and saw the queens laughing, Yudhishthir told them, "Don't laugh." And Krishna said, "Let them laugh." So it seems, why would Krishna do that? Normally, even if somebody is uncultured or somebody is impulsive and they are laughing, we would tell somebody, "Don't laugh, this is not the right thing to do." This is not the right thing to do. So, once I was giving a class, and then some person was asking like too many questions and in a very argumentative mood. So then I gave an answer, and then whatever answer, it was logical or whatever, so everybody started clapping. And then I could see all this person far away that he felt insulted by that. So I told him, please don't clap. You know, we are not here to earn some brownie points. No, I'm here to basically create a framework for a discussion. So the point over here is that why would normally we wouldn't want somebody to, if somebody is already in a sense humiliated, we don't want to, as we say, add salt to the wound. So why would Krishna do something like that? Why did Krishna not only didn't stop them for laughing, but rather he stopped Yudhishthira from stopping them? So what exactly is going on over here? So we'll try to analyze that step by step. So first point is that in general, our reactions are situational. See, basically you could say there are circumstantial reactions and there are intentional reactions. So circumstantial means, see, whenever we do something, it could be that if somebody says something and we are shocked by that. So okay, that's what you told me was shocking. That's circumstantial. But when it's intentional means we have certain bias, certain agenda, and because of that we react in a particular way. So in general, as I said, if somebody falls, the cultured response is not to laugh at them. However, there is a slight difference. So there are some people who are puffed up. Krishna uses the word dambho darpo abhimanascha krodha parushyamevacha agyanam chavyatasya partha sampadamasarim. So Baldev Vidya Bhushan is commentary on the Gita actually differentiates between these three, dambha, darpa and abhimana. So there are different ways of analyzing it, but still essentially it is that Prabhupada uses pride, conceit, arrogance, he uses different words, and I won't go into the technicalities, but broadly dambha means to show oneself to be better than what one is. Dambha is in that sense to claim credit where it is not due. In the qualities of that characterize knowledge, Krishna describes 20. First is amanitvam and second is adambitvam. And the difference is amanitvam means even if I have some virtue, I don't demand respect for that virtue. So even if somebody is very scholarly, they don't put on airs and they don't demand everybody should respect me. And adambitvam means one does not actually put on airs. I am not scholarly, but I try to pretend, I try to act in such a way, I try to just pull information from here and there and create a facade of scholarship. So that is, so amanitvam, adambitvam, that is the difference. So dambha means we claim respect even when it is not due. Dambha, darpa, abhimana. So darpa is where we get pleasure. It's like the person's locus of self-worth is extrinsic. That means the person's self-worth comes primarily from how much I get respect. And abhimana is where not only I feel secure when others respect us, but that is the joy of my life. So abhimana is different from swabhimana. Swabhimana is self-respect, but abhimana is where I get pleasure when others respect me. And then I feel enraged when others don't respect me. See, there is a difference between darpa and abhimana in that sense. It's like some people, if they have low self-esteem, then if somebody doesn't even leave alone, respect them, recognize them, acknowledge them, then they sink into depression. Oh, I am worthless. Nobody values me. Nobody cares for me. So is that anger? Well, in a subtle sense, depression is anger directed at oneself. When I feel that I am not good enough to be recognized by the world, or I am not good enough even in my own eyes, And then I become angry with myself and I start beating myself down. Of course, depression can be a clinical phenomena and that's different. But in general, so the idea is, first is that I put on airs to claim respect where it is not due. Second is, if I don't get respect, I feel very insecure. And third is, when I get respect, I feel pleasure. And if I don't get it, I exhibit anger. So when somebody is putting on airs, when somebody is very puffed up, then actually it is human psychology, not necessarily a desirable trait, but there is a certain pleasure in seeing the proud fall. If somebody is very puffed up, if somebody normal person falls, then okay, it's bad. But if somebody is putting on airs and then they fall, there is a certain pleasure, you know, it serves him right. Now, it's not necessarily a desirable thing, but it's human psychology that if somebody is claiming respect where it is not due, then when that respect is taken away, there is a certain pleasure over that, in that. And that pleasure, so yes, is it desirable? Well, you could say it is circumstantial. It's not necessarily a good thing, but circumstantially, if somebody is putting on airs and then that person takes a fall. So it was just a circumstantial reaction. So circumstantially, all of us may do certain things, some of which are desirable, some of them are undesirable. But that's one thing. See, circumstantial is okay. It is the circumstance provokes the reaction. But when something is intentional, means we want to deliberately put down the person, humiliate the person, denigrate the person. So Draupadi and the queens did laugh. But when it is portrayed as if she taunted him thereafter. So when it's taunted, and the specific taunt, now that is not just, oh, you know, in this situation something funny happened. But I'm using that situation, or that situation is being used to humiliate that person. And to connect that with something bigger and then put the person down. So that is a misrepresentation and that is wrong. So in general, when people speak something to us, say if we are in the position of Duryodhan, when somebody laughs at us, so at that time a lot will depend on, no, is this person my well-wisher or is this person my ill-wisher? Is this person my friend? Is this person my enemy? So is this person looking for opportunities to hurt me? And this is the opportunity that they found. So then if we come to know that, like if this person is deliberately wanting to push me down, then our response will be very different. But if it's just circumstantial, then don't take that seriously. So there is a time when harsh words may be spoken, even if they are spoken, or some annoying or infuriating actions are done, but one doesn't have to take them seriously. So the classic example, if you want to take it up for this, is another situation where Sita spoke harsh words to Lakshman. She accused him of having an evil eye towards him, her. And she told him, go from here to Ram. If you don't go, you will never be able to fulfill your evil desires. I will die rather than be touched by you. If for a person who is honest, even the accusation of dishonesty is painful. For a person who is pure, even the accusation of impurity is painful. So we could say that Lakshman would naturally have felt hurt. And felt hurt, angered, shocked. And if we say comparatively, Sita's accusation against Lakshman is far more severe than Draupadi's action toward Duryodhan. Isn't it? But there is no evidence that Lakshman ever held a grudge against It is Sita spoke that in the time because the situation was very, very tense. She spoke that and Lakshman also reacted, he went away from there. But Lakshman didn't hold a grudge against it. When they found Sita was abducted, Lakshman didn't say, serves her right. I told her this is a trick, she didn't listen to me, now serves her right. He was there by the side of Ram to help him recover Sita. On the other hand, what happened with Duryodhan? He not only took that as a grudge, but he planned. And for him, later on, when he schemed to have Draupadi disrobed, it was a way of getting back at Draupadi. The attempt to disrobe Draupadi was driven not just by lust. It was also driven by arrogance, by the hunger for power. So, I was in America and I was talking with a devotee who works in criminology. He works in crime and various. So, in the West, often the perception is created that in India, women are very insecure and there is violation of women that happens. And now, it is true in some ways, especially in some parts of the country. But to generalize, India is a different thing. But anyway, so we were discussing various things and he made this point that when a woman is violated, it is not just because of lust. It is also because of power. So I asked him, what do you mean by that? That actually, if it's simply lust, then somebody, people can just go to places where they can get their lust gratified. But there is that urge to dominate, to control. It's a power game also. I want to control you. So I want to not only violate you physically, but I want to dominate you and in that sense dishonor you. So when Duryodhana did that, he tried to disrobe Draupadi disrobed. It was an attempt to get back at her. You humiliated me, I will humiliate you. Now, this is when one is, one of the problems with the anarthas, whether it is lust, anger, greed, envy, pride and illusion, it is not only that they delude us when we are angry, when we are pride, but actually, The one way they delude us is they completely take away our sense of perspective. Sense of Prabhupada defines intelligence, the 10th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, as intelligence means to see things in their proper perspective. Proper perspective means this is this important, this is this important. And to not see things in proper perspective means to make small things very big. So, for example, say, sexual desire, say sexual craving, lust. What it did to Ajamil? Now, yes, he saw some sight. It was provoking. There was some. It was titillating. It was agitating. But when lust takes control, what happens? It takes away one sense of perspective. To gratify that, to reject one's own parents, to reject one's own wife, to lose one's position in society. And to act immorally from a brahmana to become a thief and a criminal, that was horrible. So sense of perspective is lost completely. So for Duryodhan, what happened? He took offense to such a degree that he lost his complete sense of perspective. Okay, you fell and somebody laughed at you. Okay, that was a bad thing, and you may want to get back. But getting back by publicly disrobing and dishonoring a respectable woman is monstrously out of proportion. It is like we are in a particular room and an ant comes and bites us. Or we are in a particular house and an ant comes. Imagine there is a king. King comes to a particular house as a guest and the king is being honored over there. But there an ant comes and bites. And the king gets so angry and the king has a bomb dropped to destroy the whole house and destroy everyone in the house. Okay, it was an oversight that, maybe they should have cleaned the place so that ant wouldn't come and bite you. But there has to be a sense of proportion. So, Now, what disturbs us the most reveals what shelters us the most. What we fear reveals what we hold dear. In many ways, our reactions to situations tell us about ourselves. So, why was Duryodhana so agitated that he went to such an extent to take that, to try to get back at Draupadi? Now, it was, of course, he had deep-rooted envy for them, for the Kaurav, for the Pandavas. And he had done a lot before. He had already tried to have the Pandavas burned alive. But the point here is that he was very, he was in a sense very insecure. He wanted prestige. And when he saw the Rajasuya Yajna and the prosperity of the Pandavas in terms of the gifts that they had got, in terms of the opulence of the palace that they had that had been built for them, he realized that I'm outclassed over here. That if you know we treat somebody as a, okay, he's my equal, my rival, my competitor. Sometimes he's better than me, sometimes I'm better than him. But then someone one day it's exposed that they're not just better than us, they are in a different class. So it's not so easy to deal with that. So he felt especially, he was already insecure, he was already envious. And then on top of that, when he was humiliated, it was extremely painful for him. So I made the three levels I was discussing the problem. First is that why did Draupadi laugh? Then second is why the distortion misrepresents, saying that she taunted, and that particular taunt indicates that she had something in her heart and that came out. Well, that is a misrepresentation. But then the third, we could say probably the biggest question comes up is that why did Krishna stop Yudhishthir from stopping the queens when they were laughing? So now one extreme explanation, I gave a class in London once, and after that one devotee said that I was talking about how in the Western world people are very uncomfortable with the idea of religious violence, and often because of that things get equated artificially. That, you know, when I was in America, a common perception in America is that that Hindus and Muslims are constantly at riots and they are constantly at their necks killing each other. Now, actually speaking, if we put the partition aside, the number of people who have been killed in riots, in Hindu-Muslim riots, is actually less than the number of people who are killed in car accidents in America. So there is tension, no doubt, but the point is that it is said that, okay, these people, both people are religious fanatics and both keep fighting with each other. So it's not like that. And even if there's religious violence, so what happens is the Bhagavad Gita is a prominent book, and the Bhagavad Gita is a book which gets Arjuna to fight. So people feel very uncomfortable with that. Both are epics. The Ramayana and the Mahabharata are centered on a war. And that also makes people very uncomfortable. If we consider the biblical stories, there are wars described, but neither the Old Testament nor the New Testament is centered on a war. And more often than not, in the Old Testament, the Jews are the victims of the war. Of course, they win some wars, they lose many wars. But there is that perception. So I was giving a class, and so I explained how Krishna did everything to prevent war. So when people say the Gita book which is meant to incite war, so I talk about in terms of three C's. What was the cause? What was the cause? It was not, there is a war which is fought for we could call it, see, in some religions, if somebody does not believe certain things, then they are considered to be heretics. And the heretics should be killed. That's the idea. So if we see in the Mahabharata and the Ramayana, the wars are not fought against wrong believers. They are fought against wrongdoers. There's a big difference. That Duryodhana or Ravana, they were not killed because they did not believe in a particular conception of God. They did not believe a particular religion. They were killed because they did grievously wrong activities. So, the point I was making is, you look at the cause of the war, all the atrocity that they had done. We look at the context, what all the Pandavas did to prevent the war. Krishna himself went as Shantidutra. And then look at the content. The Bhagavad Gita hardly contains any inflammatory speech, no hate speech. There's not even a one single reminder to Arjuna that just see how they had dishonored Draupadi. Generally, if you want to get somebody to do some violence, the easiest way to incite people is by emotional manipulation. Remind them of how bad the other person is. And then you'll get them to fight. Now, Krishna doesn't do that even once. So it's remarkable. So in the causes, cause, context and content, all three, we see that the Bhagavad Gita is not really meant to incite war. That is just circumstantial. But when I was explaining how Krishna himself went as a Shantidut, so there was this devotee who raised a question. He said, actually it is Krishna who wanted this war to happen. And that's why Krishna externally was telling, was making the plea for peace. But Krishna internally as the Paramatma was preventing Duryodhana from listening to it. Now, I said, first of all, you know, how do you know what Krishna as the Paramatma is doing in whose heart? As of now, we don't have any commentaries by our Acharyas on the Mahabharata itself. The Mahabharata is just too big to write a commentary on. You know, the translation of the Mahabharata, there are 2-3 scholars who have done it. And it took them 11 years or 15 years or 20 years, full-time work just to translate the book. Leave alone comment on it. So we don't have that. And more importantly, see, Krishna, can we say that Krishna wants the war to happen? Krishna wanted millions of people to die? Not exactly. See, Krishna, what Krishna wants is that we come face to face with ourselves and then we make a choice. See, what does it mean? We come face, sometimes by Krishna's arrangement, circumstances are created for us where we are confronted with our weaknesses. So wherever we are weak, that is where we get provoked. And then when we are brought face to face, either we succumb or we seek strength in Krishna and we rise up. So to understand this, let's have another comparison. Let's look at another situation where Krishna deliberately provoked someone. Which is the example where Krishna provoked someone? From the 10th canto of the Bhagavatam. That pastime which is very often depicted through pictures. One of Krishna's miraculous activities. Sorry. Whom did Krishna provoke? Deliberately provoke. Indra, yes. So, now let's consider. Actually here at least all that Krishna has done is stop Yudhishthir from stopping others from laughing at Duryodhan. But Krishna in the Bhagavatam does much, much more. First thing is, he stops the Vrajavasis from offering the puja to Indra. So, if we don't expect honor and then we are not honored, I didn't expect it. But if we expect honor and then we don't get honor, then that's agitating. So what happens is, Indra was habituated to that honor and Krishna stopped it. And it's one thing to stop something from being done, to make matters worse, Krishna rationalizes the stopping of that sacrifice by speaking a wrong philosophy. What is that wrong philosophy? Krishna, sorry? Yeah, Karma Mimamsa. That nature is basically mechanical, not personal. What do you mean by that? Mechanical or personal? That nature is mechanical means that if you do this, you will get that. So, or nature is personal means, yes, if we do this, this is done to please XYZ. And when they are pleased, then they do this for us. Then they give this to us. So, there are these two visions. So, modern science has this vision that nature is mechanical. And there are mechanical aspects to nature. But nature or all of reality definitely is not mechanical. So now, it's not just a wrong philosophy which Krishna is speaking. It's a wrong philosophy meant to minimize Indra's position. That means Indra is simply like the figurehead. It's like having a post without any power. In India, we have the Prime Minister and the President. So, all the power is the Prime Minister. The President really has no power. In Britain, they have still have the royalty, they have still have the Queen. But the Queen is just a figurehead. So, it's if somebody is a powerful person and they are called a figurehead, it is actually very annoying. It is very irritating. So, Krishna does that to Indra. So, basically, the Karma Mimamsa philosophy reduces Indra to a figurehead. That actually, if you do your duty, there is no need to worship Indra. He is forced to give rains. And Indra gets agitated. So now, why would Krishna do something like this? So that is for a purpose. That to force Indra to confront his own arrogance. So then Indra goes completely wild with anger and he tries to destroy the Brajavasis. The sheer amount of action that he takes is again disproportionate. Your sacrifice is stopped, but what do you do because of that? You destroy the whole, try to destroy the whole village and all the residents over there. There Krishna intervenes and he protects everyone. And after that, when he is humiliated, when all his efforts are frustrated, what does he do at that time? That time, he chooses a humble position. And what does that humble position? He comes and offers his prayers to Krishna. So, sometimes there are wounds within us, there are weaknesses within us. And Krishna may bring them to the forth. Krishna may bring them into prominence through certain situations so that we get an impetus to cure them. So, the way things work in nature is paradoxical. So, everything that pains is not harmful. And everything that harms is not painful. Everything that pains is not harmful. So, for example, if somebody is exercising and when they are exercising, then the muscle starts straining. So, now that pain is not actually harmful. So, in exercise, it's micro trauma in the muscles break and then they reform. So, that is actually the way we become stronger. So, all that pains is not harmful. When a woman is pregnant and there is labor pain, if then there are contractions and all that, it's painful, but it's not harmful. In fact, a new life is going to come into the world. So, all that pains is not harmful. This is 1837 in the Bhagavad Gita. Yattad agre visham iva pariname amrutopamam. That which is like poison in the beginning can taste like nectar in the end. So, when Krishna is provoking either Indra or Duryodhana, it's painful, it pains for them. But all that pains is not harmful. That pain is there, but the purpose of that pain is to actually force them to face the reality of their own arrogance and then choose what to do. And conversely, all that harms is not painful. All that harms is not painful. So sometimes we may have some disease in the body which doesn't cause any dysfunctionality, at least normally. That's one of the reasons why cancer is so feared, because quite often cancer just grows inside the body without any symptoms. And later on, when the cancer is detected, quite often it's so advanced that it's very difficult to cure. So all that harms is not painful. So for us, sometimes we have certain anarthas. They are harming us internally, but they are not painful right now. So we may have arrogance, we may have certain other weaknesses. They are harming us, but there is no pain involved over there. So Indra had an ego, Duryodhana had an ego. And that ego was harming them. That ego was preventing them from functioning properly. It was from realizing their spirituality, how to grow spiritually. It was harming their spiritual prospects. But it was not painful. So that's why Krishna says that. Krishna also talks about this in the next verse, 1838, that yattad agre amrutopamam pariname vishamiva. So we get that it is actually, it tastes like nectar, although it will become like poison in the end. So when we say all that harms is not painful, what we mean is right now it is not painful. The pain will come, just like cancer, the pain will come later. But right now it is not. So we could say both Indra and Duryodhana had that cancer inside them. The cancer of arrogance, dambho darpo abhimanascha, which Krishna says are the characteristics of the demoniac nature. Now Indra was not a demon. Indra is a devta, but he had some, at least in this past time, he is exhibiting some demoniac characteristics. And Duryodhana of course had a demoniac nature. So then when this is brought forth, when this provocation comes up, so like somebody comes to know, okay, I've got cancer. And what do? You treat the cancer or cover it up? So, you know, when we all face situations when, say, we are dishonored or we are exposed to be not all that we thought we were or we portrayed we were. So we think I am this good, and some situation comes up which shows that actually you're not that good. So you are quite poor. So we portray that, say, we are very learned, and then somebody asks us some question in a public forum where not only are we sure that we don't know, but what we know also is wrong. So then what happens? Dishonor can lead to two reactions. Dishonor can either lead to humility or it can lead to humiliation. Now, what is the difference between humility and humiliation? Humiliation is false ego frustrated. Humility is false ego rejected. We all have a false ego. False ego in the sense that we often claim respect which is not due for us. And in one sense, it's a part of culture and society that we respect each other. But there are some situations when our reality is exposed. And when that is exposed, if we hold on to that false ego, now I want respect, and how dare you take away the respect that is due for me, then what happens is it's false ego reject, false ego frustrated. And that frustration leads to anger. So both, in one sense, Duryodhana and Indra chose that response. When their honor was taken away, when they were dishonored, both of them became angry. But the difference is that for Indra, the anger was temporary. And afterward, he came to his senses. On the other hand, for Duryodhana, their anger was not temporary. He held on to it, and then eventually he acted on it in the most brutal way. So you could say Indra chose humility. And Indra's, if you see later on, Krishna tells Indra, Indra offers certain prayers to Krishna, and Krishna says, I did this deliberately. Krishna did not publicly strip away Indra's position. But Krishna told him, you know, you can keep the position, but have the right disposition. The right disposition is have a service attitude. Use what you have to do good to others. But Duryodhana unfortunately never chose to have the right disposition. And the result was an explosion. So it was not that Krishna, caused the war. It is Krishna who did what he could to prevent the war when he came as Shantidut. But at this particular point, when Krishna stopped Yudhishthira from stopping the queens from laughing, as is described in the Bhagavatam, the purpose was that he wanted Duryodhana to confront himself. Okay, how seriously should this be taken? It's a small thing, keep it small. So, but as I said, our weaknesses, our impurities, they make us lose perspective. And instead of keeping small things small, we make them very big. And that was what eventually caused the war. It was Duryodhana's refusal to take that dishonor gracefully. That was what caused the disaster. And we see that sometimes if somebody makes a joke at someone and they just laugh it away, then what happens is, oh, this is a good-natured person. They can take a ribbing. In a sense, it just reveals that this person is not so touchy. This person is not hypersensitive. So it also, the ability to let passing wound just pass away, that passing some verbal barbs just pass away, that actually reflects a person's emotional maturity. So unfortunately, Duryodhana did not have that. And as Prabhupada would often say, that one's greatness is seen by one's ability to tolerate provoking situations. So sometimes provoking situations come circumstantially. Sometimes Krishna may create those circumstances deliberately. So that to show, do we tolerate or we don't tolerate? So for all of us, now we all have certain weaknesses within us. And all that harms may not be painful. But just because we are gliding along right now, that doesn't mean that things are going to always be the same. We all will be provoked. And if we are strengthening ourselves spiritually, we cannot wish away our weaknesses. But if we are at least building our sources of strength, we can't wish away if we have lust, anger, greed, envy, all these. We can't just wish them away. But just because they are not troubling us too much now, doesn't mean that we may not be provoked in the future. So if we are preparing our spiritual strengths, so that is by our study of scripture, that is by our sadhana, then when the provoking situations come, we will be able to turn towards our sources of strength and face those provocations without getting provoked. So rather than choosing to get provoked, we will become more connected with Krishna. And then we will be able to tolerate and transcend those situations. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on the topic of where the Bhagavatam meets the Mahabharata, the misfortune in the palace of illusion. So I discussed about how the basic principle of illusion is a mismatch between a substance and appearance. So to create illusion also requires expertise. So at one level, illusion is in the eyes of the observer. But for the eyes of the observer to perceive things in a wrong way, it requires the expertise of the person who creates that. So Maya is the demon who created this palace of illusion. And so Maya Sabha refers to both the palace created by Maya and the palace of illusion. And in that palace of illusion, Duryodhana went into a double illusion. One was the physical illusion where he mistook the water to be the water to be land and slipped and fell. But the bigger illusion where he went into was that he chose his arrogance, he chose to feel humiliated when he was dishonored instead of becoming humbled. And I discussed three questions with respect to this pastime. Why did Draupadi laugh? So I discussed that it is a circumstantial reaction. Normally, we won't no cultured person would laugh at somebody falling. But if somebody puts on airs, there is a certain satisfaction in seeing an artificially puffed up person being put in their place again. So the demoniac have a very extrinsic sense of self-worth. And Dambha Darpa Abhimana. So to seek a honor where it is not due, and to feel secure only when one is honored, and to feel pleasure when one is honored, or to feel fury when one is not honored, that is Dambha Darpa Abhimana. And Duryodhana exhibited that. So it was circumstantial. It was not necessarily a desirable reaction, but circumstantial. Then second is, did Draupadi taunt Duryodhana? That is a dramatization, which is a distortion. It's not found. I talked about how the Patantara, the critical editions which are done, it doesn't talk about that particular incident at all. So that dramatization is a distortion because it misrepresents Draupadi's heart. It was just Draupadi had no desire to deliberately humiliate Duryodhana. It was a situation and it provoked something. It is not that she connected Duryodhana with his father and like that. That was much more serious. So then third question was, why did Krishna stop Yudhishthira from stopping the queens from laughing? So there I talk is, sometimes Krishna creates situations where we are forced to confront ourselves. That means confront our lower selves or confront our weaknesses. And in that, so I talked about, say, Duryodhana being humiliated, sorry, Duryodhana being laughed at, or Duryodhana being treated in a improper way, and Lakshmana being treated in an improper way. Lakshmana just, okay, it was circumstantial, let it stay over there. But Duryodhana held on to it, and what did he do? He got back at her, and his getting back at her was by trying to disrobe her, it was monstrously disproportionate. Like in some house, an ant bites us and we blow up the whole house and kill everyone in that house. So that is what actually our anarthas, our weaknesses, they destroy our intelligence by destroying our sense of perspective. And then I compared, say, Indra being dishonored and Duryodhana being dishonored. So actually what Krishna did to Indra was even more. Not only stopped the honor, but also gave a false philosophy, that which reduced Indra to a figurehead. That instead of explaining how nature is personal, he said nature is simply mechanical. And Indra also got angry, but afterwards his anger came down. And then he chose humility. So why did Krishna provoke like this? Because I talk about this principle that all that pains is not harmful, and all that harms is not painful. So that provocative situation where they were dishonored, that was painful. That it was pain, but it was not harmful. Why? Because it's like it's being confronted with something which we can then deal with. So like exercising or pregnancy, then it pains, but it's not harmful, and all that harms is not painful. Like a cancer inside, it is harming us, but it doesn't pain at that time. So our anarthas are like that, and sometimes Krishna creates situations where it's painful, but that pain reveals to us something that is harmful inside us, and then we can deal with it. So when we are dishonored, so when we are not respected as we should be, as we expect to be, then at that time we can either choose humility or humiliation. When we choose humiliation, that means we hold on to the false ego. I deserve this respect. How dare you don't give it to me? So the humiliation is false ego frustrated, and that leads to anger and an unhealthy reaction. But humility is false ego rejected. Oh, you know, actually I thought I was a big person, but actually I'm simply a servant. So if Krishna wants to me to serve in a big way, I'll serve in a big way. If Krishna wants to take away that big position and let me serve in a small way, I'll serve in that way also. So Krishna did not take away Indra's position, but Krishna corrected his disposition. But Duryodhana, he refused to correct his disposition. Unfortunately, that was what caused the war. So it is to say that Krishna caused the war is to misrepresent things. You know, so it is not that Krishna provoked Arjuna to fight the Kurukshetra war. Rather, if you look at the cause of the war, we look at the context, Krishna himself tried to prevent the war, and we look at the content of the Bhagavad Gita. It's not a war-inducing book at all. So Krishna didn't cause, Krishna is not the, even if Krishna provokes a particular situation, Krishna is not the cause of that situation. That provocation simply exposes what is inside. And then it is for us to respond appropriately. So the caliber of our character, our greatness is seen by how we can tolerate provoking situations. So we all have certain weaknesses inside us, which may not be troubling us right now, but we need to be building our spiritual strengths, so that when provocative situations come, when our weaknesses inside get provoked, we will be able to face them gracefully. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Are there any questions or comments?
Hare Krishna, thank you for wonderful class. My question is not exactly with the topic, but little different. Mahabharata meets the Bhagavatam. So many times there are many incidents in Mahabharata which are not at a matching with the incidents mentioned in Bhagavatam. And just like Bhagavatam mentions that Duryodhana removed Vidura out of force when he advised Dhritarashtra for killing the Duryodhana. And in Mahabharata we see that actually Vidura was present right next to Dhritarashtra, advising him while war was happening. Mm-hmm. What view went wrong and all those things. Also the incidents of where the Draupadi is glorified, the Draupadi's humility or Draupadi's compassion has been glorified. Ashwatthama's diamond has been removed from his head.
Okay.
So in Mahabharata we see the same incident. Draupadi was not present in the incident. The whole incident happened in the ashram of the Vyasadeva, where Ashwatthama himself removed that money and gave it to the Krishna. And Krishna told, you remove that money and give. So no reconciliation with Krishna Arjuna. So many understanding I heard about such kind of reconciliation, that it's a kalpa bhed, it's a kind of interpolation, or you can say Bhagavatam especially focus on pancham purusharth and this also focus on dharma artha kama moksha. So but sometimes if there's no slightest of things are matching, is there any other way to reconcile all these things?
Yeah. Yeah, it's really not related to the class, but I'll take a long time to answer this. Okay, are there any other questions? You have a question, Mataji? That's all? Two questions? Okay. I'll just answer this, then we'll move forward. Hello. So, there is a significant mismatch between the narratives of the same incident in the Mahabharata and the Bhagavatam. So, how do we reconcile it? Well, it's not that easy, and first we need to ask this question, why do I need to reconcile it? See, it's important that whenever a question comes up, it is important not just to seek the answer to the question, but it's also important to question the question. In general, we progress toward greater learning, not just by getting the right answers, but by asking the right questions. So, in general, if we consider, say, when Bhagavatam is spoken by Shukadeva Goswami, is it that Parikshit Maharaj is ignorant? We see Parikshit Maharaj does have reasonable amount of knowledge, and there are sages also over there. So, is it that they didn't notice? Is it that, say, we are more intelligent than them? that we notice this contradiction, they don't notice it? No. I mean, it would be quite presumptuous for us to claim that we study Shastra for a few hours on some days, and then the sages who have devoted their lives to studying Shastra and discussing it, that we know more than them. So the point is that this question is not important for them. So why is this question important? Let's put this way. That, okay, we may say, you know, it's an incident, you know, what actually happened? Isn't it important to know that? Well, yes, we could say, put it that way. But as you rightly said that, it was understood that when incidents are being described, that the incidents can happen in different kalpas, and the important point is not just the literal narration of the incidents. The important point was what is there to learn from it. So again, this doesn't mean that the history is not important. And if we consider pendulum, I do this monks podcast where we have discussions with different devotees. Just yesterday I had a discussion with Radhika Raman Prabhu, elaborate discussion, and I think today it will be published. So we discussed the same point, that if we consider pendulum, that say one extreme is to focus entirely on the historicity of everything. Historicity means the historical accuracy. And somebody focuses entirely on proving this is right, and somebody focuses on proving that it is wrong. So that one extreme is historicity, is insistence on historicity. And the other extreme is to treat everything as mythology. Now mythology doesn't necessarily mean that it is false, but mythology simply means that this is taught, this is spoken to give some lessons. And the literal doesn't matter at all. All that matters is the lessons. So now we might think that it's that, you know, we have to insist on the historicity of everything. And we will say the calling anything as mythology is wrong. Now in today's world, when the word mythology is used, it is not used to say that it is false. It is used, we sometimes are very reactive to certain words. Just like Sarvam Bhattacharya said that, why Brahma is there? You know that, Mukti Padesa Daya Bhag. So he says, not Mukti, don't have Mukti over there. So we sometimes get reactionary about certain words. So mythology simply means that this particular story has a great level of meaning. And certain stories acquire great meaning for certain cultures. And why do those acquire the meaning? Now, when the meaning is acquired, the meaning is derived from the story, but it's not just literally the literal narration of the story. There's much more that becomes associated with that. So mythology is basically stories with a lot of meaning associated with them. And then sometimes the stories themselves are completely imaginary. Sometimes the stories may have some basis in fact. We don't know about that. But mythology basically is not the fact that it's imaginary, but that more important than the story is other things. So we generally think that mythology is something we want to reject, and historicity is something that we insist on. But that has never been our tradition's mood. In fact, there is an incident where Srila Prabhupada was in Ahobilam. And the devotees asked Prabhupada, that they say that, that the local pandits over here say that Narasimhadev appeared over here. And Prabhupada's answer is, Prabhupada says that Narasimhadev is everywhere. The point is not where he appeared. The point is that we should worship him. Ito Narasimha Parato Narasimha. So, that now Prabhupada is not saying that Lord Narasimhadev didn't appear over there. Prabhupada, if you look at the conversation carefully, Prabhupada is saying don't give so much importance to that. That is not the point. The point is that, okay, Narasimhadev is to be worshipped. So this the balanced understanding is there is history, but there is much more than history. If the Mahabharata were simply history, well, throughout history so many wars have happened. Why are we talking about it right now? So it's not entirely mythology, and our focus should not be simply treating it as mythology, nor is our focus simply focusing on its historicity. Our focus is that each rendition of a story is told from a particular perspective to tell a particular lesson. So we focus on, and now if that, now sometimes people can have very you could say completely opposite perspectives. Like you can clearly see that certain people have certain agendas. So the classic example which I often give is that, now if say somebody is to be recommended for somebody is recommended for initiation or for some responsibility in some moment, and we might, if somebody wants to support them, they might say that he had problems in the past but he's steady now. They take the same points and say he's steady now but he had problems in the past. Now what happens? See, in general writing it is said that whatever comes at the end of the sentence is what stays in the people's minds. So you are saying the same points, but one person who wants to recommend the person will say, yeah, he had problems in the past but he's steady now. Somebody who wants to oppose that recommendation will say, yeah, he's steady now but he had problems in the past. So what happens is that now this is agenda driven, but whenever any particular incident is told, the important thing is what is the lesson being drawn from it. That the incident itself is not unimportant. What happened is important, but what is the point from it is more important. If you see this striking contrast between Prabhupada's way of approaching Arjuna in the first chapter and the second chapter. First chapter, Prabhupada is saying that Arjuna is such a thoughtful person. He is, even in the war, even in the face of a war, he's not just fighting, he's thinking about his actions. And such a person is suited to receive the wisdom of the Bhagavad Gita. And right from the first verse of the second chapter, Prabhupada says, he's crying, tears are a sign of ignorance, they're a sign of bodily attachment, and this is all a sign of skin disease. So what happened over here? In the first chapter, Prabhupada is focusing on Arjuna's qualifications for being enlightened. Madhusudana Saraswati, in the Gita commentary, says the whole purpose of the first chapter is to establish Arjuna's qualification for being enlightened. And second chapter, okay, you are qualified to be enlightened, but you are not enlightened right now. That is the focus, that Arjuna is not enlightened. So now we could say that the historical aspects can be reconciled. You know, it's a different perspective. So, but sometimes the historical aspects may not be so easily reconcilable. So the point is, that is not the important thing. So yes, some, like our Acharya has described that there are two Varahas. There's Shweta Varaha, so like that there are different Varahas. So, our understanding of history, this is this emphasis on the literal accuracy of facts comes from the Abrahamic notion of linear time. Linear time means time is going from place A to place B. So, in the Christian understanding, time is going toward the second coming of Jesus when there will be deliverance. So their idea is time is, history is going somewhere linearly. Whereas even in the Western world before Christianity, the Greco-Roman civilization had a cyclic understanding of time. So in the cyclic understanding of time, history is not going anywhere. But by learning from history, we can go somewhere. You understand the difference? History is not going anywhere. It is the same four yugas are going to come. Cyclically it is going on. So what exactly happened? If history is going in a particular direction, then what exactly happened? Which event led to which event? That becomes extremely important. But if history is not going anywhere, it's cyclic. So Krishna comes, establishes dharma, and dharma is established. After that again adharma comes up. Again Krishna comes, establishes dharma, again a dharma comes up. Sambhavami, yuge. It goes on. So in our tradition, history, we could say historicity, not history. Historicity is the critical study about the accuracy of history. So historicity has never been considered very important. And that's why we don't have to get hung up about these questions. So yes, now if we don't understand this fundamental, you could say presumption or fundamental vision or worldview, then any kind of explanation that will be given to us, it'll seem like a rationalization. Oh, you know, there's actual contradiction, but you are coming up with some explanation to rationalize it. And it can seem like that. See, we all begin with certain presumptions, any field of study. So if historical accuracy is what is important, then yes, there are differences which, if for a person for whom historical accuracy is very important, they will not be so easy to reconcile them. Some are not so easy. But it has not been important because where history is not going is not as important as where we are going by learning through history. And that's why the balance is, we accept that these things happened, but we don't get caught in the historicity of those things. So not entirely, we don't focus on historicity, we don't reduce it to mythology. We accept that it's history, but the history is given to teach us certain lessons. And what we learn from the history is more important than the history. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yes, Madhuri.
Thank you for such intriguing class for what you. Question which I had is, if something wrong happens to a devotee, even in a Krishna conscious setting, the person for personal spiritual growth chooses humility. But on the other side of it, there is also a principle of being justly fighting for what is right. So many a times, other devotee may feel that because good people are not fighting for the right cause, the wrong is going on. Yeah? So how do we arrive at a balanced understanding of these two opposite principles? That agree that we need to become humble and grow spiritually, but also look at systems and correcting at times people who are wrong, so that the organization becomes right to support in a right manner.
It's true, yeah. So, when do we try to, when something is wrong, we can choose humility and tolerate, but if something is actually going wrong, then isn't it our duty to correct it also? If we just stay by observers, then things will worsen. And we need to correct the system, and we need to correct those who are causing the system to go wrong. So how do we balance this? Yes, a lot depends on our position. I'd say there are three things: position, disposition, and situation. In general, for any decision in our life, these three factors are there. So it's not that should I fight or should I not fight. Well, it will depend on what is the situation. Is the situation worth fighting? What is my role in the situation? And then, then what is my nature also? That also matters. Say, for example, in general, in any country where there is law and order, the idea is that the government has the monopoly on the use of violence for establishing law and order. That means the police can shoot, but ordinary citizens can't shoot. Now, is it right for the government to have monopoly like that? Well, in America, they have the, for most people in the rest of the world, you know, they don't understand why Americans are so possessive about their guns. America has very relatively free access to guns, and a lot of violence happens, a lot of killing happens because of the guns. But what happened was, America was under British rule, and there was a critical war, and that war was won because Americans got access to guns and gunpowder. So in the American psyche, the idea is there is a fear that what if the government turns against us in future? Then who will protect us? So if the government becomes tyrannical, we need to have our guns. Now, we say it's a far-fetched possibility, but the idea is that that's their history and everybody is shaped by their history. So, but the principle is that in general, most countries have that principle and most citizens accept that principle, that the government has monopoly on the use of violence for maintaining law and order. Now, in many movies, they may have display what is called as vigilante justice, that some person takes up weapons and kills all the wrongdoers. But that is not the recommended way for functioning. So, in that sense, if there is wrong in society and it has to be curbed, what is the position? The government has a position of authority. And the government has to do it. The police have to do it. Say, if somebody is rioting, can I go and just shoot any rioters just because they are rioting? No. We report to the police. Now, if they are killing us and we try to defend ourselves, it's a different situation. So, then first, if something is wrong, we have to look at what is our position. Mm-hmm. Then, second is, so in general, at an individual devotee level, it's best to tolerate and forgive. Mm-hmm. At an individual one-to-one level, because if each of us start trying to fix everything that is wrong, now there is so much that is wrong in the world. So much is wrong in our community also. So if everybody starts correcting everyone else, the devotee community will become fraught with negativity and hurt feelings, angry feelings, insecurity. So overall, we need a culture of respect and overlooking of faults. Apaishunam. Apaishunam is aversion to fault finding. That Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita 16.2 is a characteristic of the godly. So that's in general, we overlook faults. But if somebody is doing something which is very severely wrong, so I talk first about position, then disposition and situation. The situation means in the action, in which situation the action was done. If somebody is, say, misappropriating money or something like that, then what is it for us to do? So in general, it is best to report to the authorities. Now, if we are in a position of authority, then definitely we have to take action. Then we can't just say that we will just let it go on as it is. But just to make it into, you know, you did this to me, so I want to correct you, so I'll do it. But unless there is an atmosphere of, unless there is a relationship of warmth and trust, correction rarely works. You know? The power to we have to all earn the right to criticize, and that right is earned only after a lot of effort and is lost with very little effort. So many times problems come up because we presume we have the right to criticize. Now we can say criticize constructively also, still it is criticizing only at one level. So we look at the situation, we look at the position. So sometimes we may have the position and then not doing the right thing. That would be dereliction of duty. That is important. If something wrong is happening and we overlook it, even though when we have the power to correct, not only the power, we have the responsibility to correct it. So, for example, Bhishma's remaining silent when Draupadi was being dishonored. That was a dereliction of duty. And Krishna was, Bhishma had to die because of that offense, of that dereliction of duty. So if we are in a position, then definitely we need to do something to correct. So actually one of the complexities or subtleties in the Bhagavad Gita is that Arjuna is in the position of a Kshatriya and he is acting like a Brahmana. So what Prabhupada says in the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita is also, it is very significant. Forgiveness is an individual virtue. Forgiveness cannot be a state policy. See, forgive, if somebody has hurt me, it is okay, it's an individual virtue to forgive. But if the Supreme Court says, or the court says, you know, we'll forgive all criminals. Well, no, that cannot work. You know, forgiveness cannot be a state policy. Say if China attacks India and India says we forgive you, then they will just seize all our territory. So there is a difference between the cultivation of individual virtue and the establishment or the creation of a policy for a systemic level. So the problem with Arjuna is that he is in a Kshatriya's position and he is acting like a Brahman. So he says, okay, they hurt me, let me forgive them. Okay, but you are in a position where you have a responsibility. You may forgive them, but if you do not do your responsibility, they are not just going to hurt you. They are going to hurt many others also. So if we are in a position, then definitely we need to take action. And of course, that action also has to be taken respectfully. And we don't humiliate the other person. We try to help them save face. Because we want them also to continue in the community and continue in bhakti. But yes, things need to be improved. And of course, even if somebody is in a position, they may or may not have the disposition. So a lot depends on individual disposition also. If we see among the Pandavas, all five are Kshatriyas. But we could say that among the five Pandavas, Yudhishthir is like a Brahmana Kshatriya. Whereas Bhima is more like a Kshatriya Kshatriya. He is Kshatriya squared. So small provocation, even the provocation is like itching for a fight. Where Yudhishthir is try to solve everything as peacefully as possible. Sometimes he might go towards the extreme of tolerating too much. When in the kingdom of Virat, Kichak tried to molest Draupadi, Yudhishthir told, just endure it. But she couldn't, and in some ways she was justified. Kichak was not going to stay silent. Kichak was going to come to her again and again. Then she went to Bhima, and Bhima dealt with it over there. So we could say that it also individual disposition also matters. So we consider the situation, how serious the problem is, when what situation that person did that action. We consider the situation, we consider our position, and we consider our disposition, and then we decide what to do. That's why, in one sense, while the principles of dharma are universal, the practice of dharma is individual. Different people might choose, two people might act dharmically, but one person might choose to act in one way, another person might choose to act in another way. So, Prabhupada, when he saw that, I'll conclude with this point, and Prabhupada, when he saw that, the Gaudiya Math was not doing much preaching, he tried to almost provoke his godbrothers. One of his Vyas Puja offerings to Bhaktivinoda Saraswati Thakur, it's quite presumptuous in one sense. Because Prabhupada was a grahastha, he was an outsider, and he's telling a sannyasi godbrothers. Basically, to put it bluntly, what he says is that, we are just satisfied eating and having our own mats while our Guru Maharaj's mission is just it dying. Why aren't we doing something? So just offering a flower to our Guru Maharaj on his Vyas Puja is not enough. But when he saw that was not happening, so he realized he has no position in the Gaudiya Math. So what did he do? He started Krishna consciousness in ISKCON. Now, when Prabhupada started preaching in the West, it's not that the first day he had a center, he immediately named it ISKCON. In many ways, he saw what he was doing as an extension of his spiritual master's mission. So in a sense, Prabhupada saw ISKCON as a branch of the Gaudiya Math. But then he saw there were various conflicts, and then it's not so much a branch of the Gaudiya Math, it is a branch of the Gaudiya Sampradaya. So he created ISKCON. So if there was no position for him to fix what was happening, then Prabhupada got a position for himself. Not in the egoistic sense, but for the sake of doing service. So then Prabhupada, he saw the situation, as I said, okay, things are not happening, and what was his disposition? See, Prabhupada did not get too much into confronting his godbrothers, tried once or twice, but then Prabhupada, we see that he had been a businessman throughout his life, he had his own independent establishment. So he just created his own, and he created it brilliantly, and we are all beneficiaries of that. So certainly, for all of us, if something is wrong, it is our responsibility to fix it. Or at least do what we can to fix it. But sometimes we may not be the right person for that. So we have to basically connect ourselves with Krishna internally and see what would Krishna want me to do in this situation. We may consult our senior devotees, consult our guides, try to consult the Super Soul in our own hearts. And then we choose to act. There is a provocative quote of Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur where he says, the world does not need any reformer. And one who thinks that the world needs a reformer, it is their own mentality that needs reformation. Now what does that mean? I have a whole class on that topic. We don't go into that. But it doesn't say that things don't need to be reformed. But to think that I will be the reformer, so he says the world already has the most expert person in charge of it. The world doesn't need you to be in charge. So what he means is that we don't become self-appointed reformers. We first of all become servants of the Supreme Reformer. So as devotees, we need to connect with, if we see something going on wrong, we need to pray and connect with Krishna, take guidance from Krishna's devotees. And then when we act as a reformer, we act in a mood of service to Krishna. Then the reformation, then our attempt to reform will actually do something constructive. Otherwise, if we are not connected with Krishna, we may fix things temporarily, but eventually things will, because our own mentality is prithak drushya, it's a separatist mentality. We think I am the reformer. Then what will happen is that, okay, even if we are completely purely motivated, after us, tomorrow somebody else will come with that same mentality, I am the reformer. And they may not be so purely motivated. So then they will end up deforming things more and more. So yes, things need to be improved, but to think that I will improve it is a mentality that itself needs improvement. We need to first connect with Krishna and act as an instrument of Krishna, then we can fix things in a way that is sustainable. Okay. So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki, Gantra Chitimad Bhagavatam ki, Gaur Bhaktivind ki, Tai Gaur Primanandi.
So the question was not asked in terms of personal application, it is more kind of preaching application that asked.
Yeah, tell it from preaching application only.
Because
no, I think
outside world you hear about Mahabharata lot.
Yeah, but
Rangadesh is a Mahabharata lot.
No, but I think even for outside also we have to create that perspective, because any thinking person, after some time they will start saying that there are so many differences. So.